Achette Children's Group presents The Strangeworlds Travel Agency, The Edge of the Ocean by L.D. Lapinski. Read for you by Abigail Hardiman. Prologue. People called them pirates, and the sailors who lived in the world of the break wore that title with pride, because when you live on a ship, and your life includes a lot of skullduggery and scallywaggery, what else would you call yourself but pirate? Every one of them certainly looked the part, and the crew who called Nyfe Shaban their captain were not without style. The sailor's appearance was as artful as it was necessary. Prosthetic legs were carved with delicate rising waves, and eye patches were made of softened leather with the crest of the ship sewn onto them. Captain Nyfe's own eye patch, nestled in the hollow of where her left eye used to be, had a spray of blue embroidered on it, a homage to her flagship, the Aconite, named after the poisonous blue flower. That night, Nyfe was engrossed in a map in front of her. She had not looked at the clock in her cabin for some time. Clocks were very important in the break because the sunrises and sunsets were so unreliable. Nyfe had been poring over a collection of maps and charts for most of the day. A half-eaten meal had been buried under an unfurled scroll several hours ago. Nyfe ran her hand over the map. It was circular, coloured in vivid inks and sealed with varnish. The surface shone and crackled. It was a map of her entire world. The world of the break. A knock sounded on her cabin door. "Yes," she said, keeping her eyes down. "Captain!" Jareem, the second mate, stuck his head around the door. "It's getting dark, and there's still no sign of the Naster." He paused, shifting the weight of the truth he carried before dropping it. "The ship's gone, Captain." Nyfe looked up from her chart. For a moment, worry flickered behind her eye. Then it vanished, replaced by her usual, unreadable chill. "Tell the crew to batten down and get themselves some food. If they can't find the ship in the light, I doubt they'll find it in the dark." Jareem nodded and excused himself. Nyfe leant back and adjusted one of the markers on her map. In the centre of the mostly blue world was a brown island that looked like a round of bread torn open. The Break. The largest island in the waters, and the one Nyfe's world was named after. A splatter of other islands spiralled out into the blue, but none of them rivalled the landmass of the Break. A sailor would need more than a day to walk from one side to the other. There was a time, when Nyfe was younger, that the map she was looking at had been twice the size. Over the years, the map had been trimmed down, cut away as the sea became smaller. It had been happening for so long now that Nyfe couldn't remember a month going by when the map had stayed as it was. Nyfe Shaban took out a thin blade from the collection at her belt. She stabbed quickly into the edge of the map and skimmed the blade around the edge of the circle, shaving off a slice no wider than her thumbnail. She picked up the hoop of chart and crumpled it in her hand before dropping it into the waste paper basket. "The world is shrinking," she said to no one. Then she took out a piece of thick recycled paper and a writing set. She had a letter to send. No, not a letter. A summons. Chapter 1. Flick twirled the magnifying glass between her fingers. The brass handle was speckled with little marks and imperfections. There was a deep scrape close to the round lens. There were little scratches running down the slender pen-like handle, and a dark smudge of something that refused to budge, no matter how often Flick cleaned it. She looked over the little instrument, not through the glass itself for the moment, enjoying the anticipation. Looking through the magnifier was a treat to be savoured. She spun the handle quickly, tripping it through her fingers in a practiced movement that she'd spent far too many nights perfecting. She was lying on her bed, the pink glow from the agate slice on top of her old lamp lighting up the room in a way that reminded her of the gentle glow of a forest made of crystal and magic, a whole other world away. A world she had walked in. Flick closed her eyes and took a steadying breath. Then she raised the magnifying glass to her right eye, keeping her left closed. The first time she had tried this, lying on her bed, she had dropped the instrument on her head. Because this was no ordinary magnifying glass, and Felicity Hudson was no ordinary person. The magnifying glass in Flick's hand contained glass that came from another world, and the little instrument had been made by someone who knew the nature of the enchantment. To look through it, if you had the right gift, was to see a hidden magic, quite literally. And as Flick looked through it, she smiled. The air around her swarmed with magic, glittering, golden, white crested glimmers on the air that drifted silently, unseen by everyone but her. Flick's smile grew into a wide grin as she watched the golden sparkles swirl and ballet dance around her bedroom. They rolled and dived through the air like glitter in water, tumbling in a swarm of magical particles. Flick raised a hand, and the swarm of magic floated soundlessly over to her, draping across her hand, fitting around her fingers like a glove. Flick could feel nothing at all, even when she squeezed her fist around some of the particles. Flick lowered the magnifying glass and pressed the round bit of it to her mouth. It was cold, and tasted a bit like a 2-pence coin she'd once licked, just to see what it was like. The magnifying glass had been made over 100 years ago, and had once belonged to a member of her friend Jonathan Mercator's family. The initials N.M. were scratched into the rim of brass. The magnifying glass wasn't exactly magical by itself. It was merely a way to see the magic that was already there. Magic, Flick now knew, was everywhere in the whole world. But that wasn't all that Flick could see. She got up off her bed and clicked the bedside lamp off before peeping through her curtains. With the light off, she could see past her own reflection, right into the garden and the housing estate beyond. The rows of houses looked dark and gloomy in the overcast night. It had been a hot and muggy day, the air full of moisture that refused to condense into rain. There was no moon to be seen, and the sky was the sort of deep purple that promised a thunderstorm later. Flick pressed a palm to the glass and wondered if that static feel in the air you got just before a storm really was just static, or something more magical. A prickle crept over her back at the thought. It was entirely possible that storms stirred up magic in the air. Anything was possible, really. She stared out at the dark for a few minutes, watching the occasional light come on in a house she didn't recognise. She waited until she couldn't stand it any longer, before raising the tiny brass magnifying glass to her eye once again. This time, the effect was electric. A bright scratch of light lit up the play area in the centre of the housing estate. It was jagged, like a lightning bolt drawn by someone whose hands were shaking. The line in the air glowed with a yellow-white light, tiny particles of magic moving in and out of it. It was carved into the air about 2 metres above the top of the slide, just waiting. A schism. A tear in the fabric of reality. A gateway to another world. A massive shiver ran over Flick's body. She had spotted the schism the day before yesterday. Although it wasn't hurting a soul, the schism reminded Flick of what could happen, and what she had done only a few weeks ago in another world. Flick stared at it until her eyes started to water, then lowered the magnifying glass and rested her head on the window. The cold glass felt nice against her warm skin, and as she listened to the creaking nighttime sounds of her home, gradually the frightened feeling gave way to a soft calm. She was safe here, and loved, and with the family she had come so close to losing. The memory of that near loss was now forever associated with schisms. Even looking at one through the magnifying glass made her feel sick with nerves. Flick had only found out about schisms recently when she had joined the secret society that was part of the Strangeworlds Travel Agency, a place of travel and magical objects, and the home of the only friend Flick had made since her family moved to Little Wyverns. The Strangeworlds Travel Agency was also the reason she was grounded right now. Her parents were acting as though Flick had gone out and robbed a bank, when all she'd really done was disappear for a day and a night. Flick pulled a face. She wished she didn't understand why they were so mad. But she did. She hadn't expected to be grounded for the whole of the summer holidays, though. There was only a week and a half left, and then she'd be off to her new school and would only have the weekends and holidays to visit the travel agency. In the distance, a siren sounded and blue lights flashed. She jumped slightly at the sound, knocking a mostly empty piggy bank off the windowsill and onto the floor with a crash. She stayed still, listening. From her parents' room, she heard a cough and the creak of their bed frame. She ought to be back in bed. Flick left the piggy where it was, pulled the curtains closed again, and slipped back into bed. The magnifying glass was still clutched tightly in her hand. Chapter 2. The kitchen was so full of carrier bags and boxes the next morning that Flick wondered if they were moving again. Fortunately, it was just one of her dad's semi-regular attempts at a clear-out. This time, he was planning on taking things to the flea market at the town hall. "Last chance saloon," he said, as Flick shoved some fruit loaf down into the toaster and took a swig of orange juice directly from the carton on the table. "Any old clothes, shoes, toys, books, get 'em bagged up. And don't do that," he added, nodding at the orange juice. He stacked another box onto a cardboard tower. The box at the bottom sagged. "Your mum doesn't like it." "We've all got the same germs." Flick rolled her eyes and went to get a glass. "Besides, you kissed Freddy, and he should be condemned under the Public Health Act." Isaac Hudson looked at his son, who was currently sporting two green candle-like protrusions from his nose.
"Maybe you do need a wipe, young man, eh?"
"Put him in the steriliser," Flick suggested. Freddy laughed, and Flick felt mollified. At least someone was prepared to humour her for her jokes. She felt a lot more affectionate towards Freddy these days, despite the snot. Moira Hudson came in then. She was wearing jeans instead of her post office uniform. "Are you ready yet, Felicity?" she snapped. Flick paused with her fruit toast halfway to her open mouth as she tried to remember what it was she was supposed to be ready for.
"It's Saturday," Moira sighed.
She clicked her tongue in the way that usually meant trouble was coming.
"You said you were going to come with me into town. But the shopping needs doing. But, and Freddy needs some more trousers. He's wearing through the knees with crawling. But, so get ready and don't spend half the day in the bathroom. You're beautiful enough as it is. Chop chop."
Flick resignedly shoved the rest of her breakfast in her gob. Ever since Flick had failed to return from the Strangeworlds Travel Agency a few weeks ago, she'd had about as much freedom as a spider trapped under a glass. She had turned up at home in the small hours of the morning with no reasonable explanation, and, understandably, her parents had questions. In an attempt to stop them giving her the third degree every 5 minutes, Flick had eventually come up with a half-hearted lie about getting lost in Little Wyverns. Her parents hadn't bought it for a second, of course, but they seemed to prefer even an obvious lie to no explanation at all. Her dad had stopped being angry after the first week or so, but Flick's mum was like a pot of water simmering on the hob. Anything could turn up the heat and send her boiling over. So Flick had been trying to just do as she was told. Her parents, and her mother in particular, were determined to keep her busy. But Flick's parents didn't know about Strange Worlds, and Flick had no intention of telling them about it either. She had made it back to the travel agency twice. The first time, shortly after her disappearance, she had managed to skive off a piano lesson to tell Jonathan she was grounded semi-permanently. The second time, Freddy had chosen the pavement outside Strange Worlds as the perfect spot to throw one of his mega tantrums, trademark, giving Flick the chance to wave frantically through the glass as her mother wrestled with him. Though Flick was grounded, apparently there was no harm in her leaving the house to entertain her baby brother around the shops. Since it was the holidays, the supermarket was packed full of parents and their offspring, who were either being kept quiet with crisps or screaming because they weren't being kept quiet with crisps. Freddy was among the latter, alternating between bleating like a goat and trying to swallow the trolley's connector key. Flick wandered over to the soft fruit whilst her mother complained loudly to no one that now the cucumbers were not wrapped in plastic, they didn't last as long. There had been an argument at home about single-use plastics the day before, when Flick crossed cling film off the shopping list in a moment of feeble rebellion. Flick was wondering why her mother thought a firmer-for-longer cucumber was more important than the great whales when she saw a familiar tousle of dark hair and a terrible tweed waistcoat that could only belong to one person. She peered around the banana display, hardly daring to hope. But it was. It was Jonathan Mercator. Flick's heart soared. He was really there, out of his precious travel agency, standing looking at fruit as though he was as boring as everyone else in the multiverse. Well, not quite as boring. Though it was August and everyone else was in shorts, Jonathan's only concession to the weather was to have left his suit jacket off. Even his shirt was still buttoned to the neck. Flick felt weirdly tickled. Seeing Jonathan in the supermarket was like seeing a turtle out of its shell. She walked over. "Hey," she grinned. She suddenly felt as though her legs were filled with springs. "It's so good to see you." "Oh!" Jonathan blinked rapidly behind the lenses of his glasses, and a smile spread across his face. He put the avocado he'd been examining into his basket.
"Hello."
Flick glanced over to where her mother was trying to wrestle her shopping list out of Freddy's mouth.
"It's been like trying to escape Alcatraz at home. How are you?"
"Better, thank you." He patted the back of his head, where there was a ridge of scar where a rock had hit him only a few weeks ago. It was a reminder of the dangers of his line of work. Jonathan's travel agency was the only one like it in the world. And Flick was one of only a few people who knew the secret, that when the Strange Worlds Travel Agency sent you on a trip, they didn't send you on a plane. The old travel agency was filled with an assortment of old suitcases, each one different from the last, and each one of those suitcases could transport you to another world. All you had to do was step inside. Flick glanced at the contents of Jonathan's basket. There was a tin of vegetable soup keeping the single avocado company. It was weird to think of Jonathan doing anything as mundane as eating meals.
"Does my shopping meet with your approval?" he asked.
She laughed.
"I guess. So, how's business?"
"Slow and steady, as the saying goes," he shrugged. "I revisited the City of Five Lights recently. The place seems to be getting better, thanks to you."
"Thanks to Nick Device," Flick said, suddenly missing the pink and gold city and her red-cloaked thief friend with a heart-aching intensity. "She was the one who agreed to release the stolen magic back into the world. She could have kept it."
"Not everyone is that kind of thief," Jonathan said. "I spoke to Miss Device, as it happens. She's heard nothing of Overseer Glean or her cronies. It seems as though you trapped them in that other world for good.
Flick stared at some kiwis, the heavy feeling in her chest dissolving into liquid guilt. Jonathan seemed to sense how she was feeling. You saved yourself, saved Strangeworlds Society members, and ultimately the world of Five Lights itself. Without you, Overseer Glean and her thieves would have journeyed to another world and drained the magic, the life, out of it. He adjusted his grip on the shopping basket. That doesn't mean you have to feel good on a personal level about trapping people in another world. Flick hummed. Still not even sure how I did it. Have you tried to do anything since you've been away? Flick shook her head, feeling as though spying through the magnifying glass didn't really count. No experiments with your gifts? Jonathan's eyebrows rose. Why ever not? Flick shifted awkwardly. During her time with Jonathan, it had become clear that she was magically gifted, more so than he was, and more so than he had ever seen before. On her last adventure with Jonathan, she had done the impossible, torn open a schism between two worlds, and survived. But back in Little Wyverns, quite possibly the most mundane village in the multiverse, it barely seemed real. Jonathan smiled. I do miss you being there, you know. You should have come in the other week. I saw you waving. Oh. Flick blinked and smiled. She didn't think she'd ever had a friend say they missed her before. It made her feel shy, but in a good way. I would have come in, but I was with my mum. She'd only ask questions. That's pretty much all she's done since I didn't come home that night. Ah, understandable. Still, that's...
Hey, Jonathan, isn't it?
The two of them turned around to see a very tall, broad-shouldered young man in a rugby shirt. He was holding a 4-pint bottle of whole milk in one hand, and he was grinning good-naturedly. At the sight of him, Jonathan seemed to shrink. He grasped his shopping basket tightly in two hands.
Hello,
he said, his voice slipping upwards several octaves.
Hey, the young man said again. It is Jonathan, isn't it?
Jonathan nodded like he was one of those dolls you keep in the back window of a car.
Yes, and you're Anthony. That's me.
Anthony looked at Flick, and then back to Jonathan.
Are you going to introduce me to your sister, friend?
This is Felicity, Jonathan said, his eyes staying on Anthony like they'd been glued. She's just a friend.
Nice to meet you, Felicity, just a friend.
Anthony shook her hand and she smiled. It was like shaking hands with a friendly giant.
Nice to meet you too. So, how do you know Jonathan?
It seemed incredibly unlikely that this cheerful, freckled mountain of a young man was a member of the Strangeworlds Society. But she wasn't about to rule it out either.
Oh, I'm a student rep. I work at the college up the road.
He gestured with a thumb.
I was helping out at the open day, and Jonathan here was one of the few people who didn't laugh at my efforts to tell people about courses.
You were very good, and knowledgeable, I mean, Jonathan said.
His cheeks had gone rather pink. Anthony rolled his eyes, but seemed pleased.
Thanks. Did you sign up for a course?
Jonathan seemed to shake himself.
Yes. I signed up for the modern geography module in the end. That was an excellent suggestion.
Anthony nodded.
No problem. Well, I'll leave you guys to your shopping. It was nice to meet you, Felicity. And I'll see you soon, yeah?
He smiled at Jonathan.
Yes, I'll see you at college.
Anthony nodded, and Jonathan gave a little wiggly-fingered wave as he turned away. As soon as Anthony had rounded the corner, Jonathan covered his face with a hand.
Oh, God! Is there any chance you could be persuaded to never mention that encounter ever again?
Flick grinned.
Really? You want me to pretend I never saw you do this?
She mocked his little wave.
Felicity, I'm begging you. He dropped his hand. Please.
All right, fine, she said, then smiled. For what it's worth, he seemed nice. Flick's mother came over then, her trolley rattling as one of the wheels tried to go the opposite direction to the other three. Come on, Felicity, let's get going, she said. She looked at Jonathan. Have we met?
Jonathan gave what could only be described as a winning smile and stuck his hand out.
I'm Felicity's friend, Jonathan. I must say, he added, I'm rather sorry Felicity never came back to help in the shop.
Flick's heart stopped. Her mother's eyes narrowed.
What do you mean?
I run a local travel agency. Felicity said she was keen to start a summer job, did a brilliant first day, and then she never turned up again.
Jonathan lied, as smooth as cream.
I thought she'd changed her mind.
Flick's heart started up again. She shook her head.
No, I just haven't been able to get down there. I'm sorry.
You never said you were looking for a summer job, her mum said suspiciously.
I've not been allowed to explain anything much.
Flick knew that wasn't true, but it was important to steer her mother away from any possible connection between Jonathan and the night she had failed to come home.
It's a shame, Jonathan went on, because she was such an asset. You don't find young people as willing to work that hard, even in little wyverns.
Moira Hudson fluffed up at the praise of her daughter.
Yes, well, Felicity has always been very mature for her age, very responsible.
Jonathan's crowd-pleaser smile stayed plastered on his face.
It's a testament to how well brought up she is, I think. A real reflection on you.
Flick wouldn't have thought her mother would be so easily suckered by such obvious flattery, but she was actually preening a little. After weeks of anger and upset, she was being smoothed over like icing on a cake. Maybe flattery was Jonathan's superpower, or maybe there was only so long you could carry on being annoyed with someone. Either way, it was amazing to watch her mum's shoulders relax for the first time in weeks. Jonathan carried on.
It would be a shame for the training I started to give Felicity to go to waste. Computers and systems and such. The sort of thing that would really shine in a CV.
Flick saw something flicker behind her mother's eyes. Moira Hudson knew enough about college and university admissions to recognise how useful this would be. She gave her daughter a shrewd look.
I'll improve my timekeeping, Flick said. Promise?
Her mum took a deep breath in through her nose.
All right, she said. But if you ever...
I won't,
Flick said quickly.
Cross my heart and all that.
We'll talk about this later,
her mum said. But Flick knew she had been won over. Freddie blew a raspberry.
Come on, Felicity. We've only got another hour on the car park.
Nice to meet you, Jonathan.
She nodded at him and started back down the aisle. Jonathan let the grin drop off his face. He fixed his tie and raised his eyebrows at Flick in a question. Flick winked at Jonathan.
See you tomorrow, she mouthed.
Jonathan tapped his watch. 10 sharp.
Chapter 3. The walls of the Strangeworlds Travel Agency were filled top to bottom with large rectangular holes, or slots, and each of these slots contained a suitcase. There were small ones, and large ones, and wicker ones, and leather ones, and ones where the locks had been welded shut with some sort of gloopy metal that felt cold to the touch. One of the suitcases, specifically a sunshine yellow one made of thick, varnished cardboard, began to fidget. It shuffled and inched, as if trying to escape from its hole. This was no easy task, as the space had been built to fit exactly, and the wriggle room was mere millimetres. But gradually, oh so gradually, the case pushed itself out of its space in the wall and tumbled to the floor with a thud. Immediately, the top was flung open
and a girl stepped out, arms held as wide as her smile.
Ta-da!
She trilled to the empty shop. Then she let her arms drop.
Oh!
Outside, a street lamp shone. The clocks on the mantelpiece ticked, and the shop was in gloom, for, as the largest clock face stubbornly told her, it was 2 o'clock in the morning. Avery Eldritch pulled a face. She folded her arms and went behind the desk. She gave the untidy desk a once-over, snorted derisively, then turned to the faded novels in the bookcase behind her and chose Terry Pratchett's Night Watch. She pulled it off the shelf, and 3 other books came with it, tumbling to the floor with loud thumps that made her wince. She swore under her breath, watching the doorway to the kitchen. Before too long, a varnished cricket bat came into view, held by a hand protruding from the sleeve of a rather fetching maroon dressing gown.
"I have to warn you," a voice squeaked. "I am armed and quite prepared to..."
"It's me," she said. "It's Avery."
The cricket bat lowered a little, and Jonathan, hair on end from sleep, peered around the doorframe. His mouth dropped open.
Averina?
Avery smirked as she took in his dressing gown and molting slippers.
"Surprised?"
"Extremely." Jonathan pushed his glasses up his nose.
"What are you doing here? Is Portia here?"
He looked around.
"No, Mum isn't here, just me."
"What's wrong?
You're not excited to see your cousin?"
She grinned nervously. Jonathan gave a small laugh.
"Sort of, cousin."
"True. I think I'm actually your aunt several times removed or something."
She folded her arms tightly, like she was hugging herself. Her expression became somewhat apprehensive.
"It's been a long time."
3 years. Since Mum died, in fact."
Jonathan put the cricket bat on the end of the desk.
"I wasn't sure I'd see you again. Does your mother know you're here?"
"Pretty sure she'll soon figure it out if she doesn't know already."
"Will she come after you?"
"She can't stand to be in the same room as our suitcase, so I doubt it. What happened to your mum really got to her."
Avery scuffed the floor with her boot.
"They forbade me from coming here after that. But a few weeks ago, we heard about your dad."
Jonathan looked up.
"Oh?" "Mum got a letter from one of the old Strangeworlds Society members. Quickspark?"
"Oh, yes. Grayson and Darylin in Five Lights."
"They explained what had happened to your dad and how you were looking for him. Wondered if we had any information. Which we didn't, I'm afraid. It was the first we'd heard of it. I said I wanted to come through and see you, but Mum and Dad said no, it was too dangerous. So I waited until they weren't looking."
She sniffed.
"I figured I'd been kept from seeing you for too long anyway, and they're too cowardly to come after me, so I've run away, basically."
"Which isn't stupid at all,"
Jonathan smirked, though without malice.
"I'd be lying if I said I wasn't glad to see you, Averina."
They smiled stupidly at each other for a minute before Avery went in for a hug, which Jonathan tolerated for 3 whole seconds before pushing her gently away.
"Care to explain the hour?"
"Miscalculation, sorry."
"Not to worry,"
Jonathan yawned.
"Anyway," Avery said, "I didn't just come here to say sorry about your dad, which I am, by the way, but there's something else. Something important."
Jonathan's yawn disappeared and his mouth snapped shut.
"What?"
"The house on the horizon," she said with an air of mystery.
Jonathan stared, unimpressed.
"The Strangeworlds Society outpost in the Desert of Dreams? What about it?
Heard from it lately?"
Jonathan tightened his dressing gown belt before pulling the enormous society register from the bookshelf and crashing it down onto the desk.
"I haven't heard from anyone lately. Besides, I don't even know for sure if it's manned."
He caught Avery's eye and said,
"Peopled, I mean, staffed."
Avery gave a small smile. I overheard my parents talking about it, about a man named Thess, who apparently lives there. Mum said he's been part of the Strangeworlds Society since the beginning.
That would make him a seriously old man, Jonathan said, flipping through the pages of the register. So, I'm assuming he's not from my world, at least.
But if he's been part of the society from the start, I thought maybe he could help find your dad.
Jonathan looked up from the book sharply. What makes you think that?
He's been around for a long time. Maybe he knows something we don't, or you don't.
I don't know a Mr. Thess, Jonathan shrugged. He looked back at the list of names.
But if he's a society member, his name should be written down. The thing is, Avery paused, my mum says he's dangerous. He's been seen around Five Lights and other worlds too, asking questions and not being polite about it. Someone said he had a gun.
Jonathan paused, a memory coming back to him.
The children in Tam's Forest said they'd seen a man who had a gun. He came out of a suitcase. Could it be him?
I hope so, Jonathan said. Last thing I need is two armed gunmen running around in and out of suitcases. Aha! He turned the book around. Thess. Danza Thess. It says here he was the Strangeworlds custodian at Phaeton's trading post before Mr. Maskelyne. I was there recently.
He touched the back of his head, remembering the pain of falling onto rocks, the abandoned mountainside, and the landscape that was bare, no outpost to be seen. The entire outpost was gone, he said to Avery. Nothing left except snow and rocks, and the ledger doesn't say where Thess went after that. Avery leaned forward to see.
Apparently the Quicksparks heard him telling people he's guarding the house on the horizon.
Well, if he is, he hasn't bothered telling me, Jonathan said. It says here that that contact for the house on the horizon is lost. He trailed off.
Another lost person? Avery said thoughtfully. Or maybe not lost, but unable to be contacted.
How do you get to a place that's always on the horizon?
Jonathan frowned.
Wait. Always? The house is always on the horizon. So if you move forward, it moves further away.
Exactly. You can see it, but you can't get to it.
But the Strangeworlds Society must have had a way of getting to it, Jonathan said. It's an outpost. There would be suitcases stored there. There must be a suitcase here that can take us there. Unless someone has moved it.
He glanced up at the empty slot in the wall of suitcases, which had been relieved of its case by his father, Daniel Mercator, just before his disappearance.
So, should we try and go there? Avery prompted.
Jonathan rubbed at his forehead. Maybe. I suppose it's worth a shot. I have no idea where the right suitcase might be, but we can start searching in the morning. It shouldn't take too long with the three of us.
Three of us? Avery asked in surprise.
Oh, yes, Jonathan grinned. Didn't I tell you? I've recruited a new society member.
Chapter 4 Flick got to Strangeworlds bang on 10. It was a joy to be out of the house, alone, with no Freddy to be pushed in a pram and entertained, and no mum or dad nagging at her to stop scuffing the heels of her shoes. Flick felt positively bouncy on her good mood. She grinned as she watched people hurrying past the travel agency as though it wasn't there. Their eyes slid from the second-hand bookshop on one side to the church on the other without blinking. The place did have the occasional visitor, of course. Not everyone was so dull in the mind that they didn't notice it. But rare were the people like Flick and Jonathan, the people born with the ability to see magic. Strangeworld's bright red sign blared over the bay window,
confidently broadcasting the name of the travel agency to the public. The gold letters looked polished and gleaming, and Flick wondered if Jonathan had given the sign a scrub since the last time she was there, though it was difficult to imagine him up a ladder or doing manual labour. Flick glanced at the tattered red patch she'd safely pinned onto her sleeve, a magnifying glass embroidered in gold with a slash of lightning in the middle of the lens shining against the red fabric. She felt a flush of pride. She felt as if she was coming home. She pushed open the door and went straight in. "See? Right on time, just like I promised." She stopped and stared. Instead of Jonathan sitting behind the desk, there was a girl about Flick's age. She had short black hair that stuck up at the front as though she'd been electrocuted. Her face was round, her dark eyes were sharp, and she looked suspiciously at Flick. The girl was wearing all black, including thick boots that laced up the front. "Can I help you?" she asked, in a tone of voice Flick found very familiar. Flick said, aware she had been staring at the girl as though she was an escaped cobra. "I was looking for Jonathan." The girl brightened. "Oh, okay," she came over. "I'm Avery," she offered a hand. "Avery Eldritch," she said. "Not heard of you yet." "I'm Flick," Flick said, shaking the pale brown hand briefly. "I help out? At Strangeworlds?" "Well, yeah." "Really?" Avery made a face that said, "Sure you do," in no uncertain terms. The two girls stared at one another. Something about Avery reminded Flick of the girls at Lawrence Academy, Flick's old school, who would go silent and just wait for you to say something, anything. And then when you did, they would laugh at you. So Flick kept quiet, teeth clamped together in case a word tried to sneak out. "Jonathan didn't tell me he had an assistant," Avery said eventually. "I'm not his assistant. I'm..." Flick wondered if she was allowed to mention the Strangeworlds Society to this girl. Surely she was, if she'd been left minding the shop. A sudden burst of annoyance flared inside her. Jonathan had replaced her, after only a few weeks, and he'd acted so eager to have her back. Was that all a ruse? Was he lying to her, yet again? Flick realised she hadn't finished speaking and went red. Avery raised her eyebrows. "You're a what, exactly?" Fortunately, Jonathan chose that moment to come into the room, fastening one of his cuffs as he walked. "Ah, Felicity," he said, as if everything was normal. "Nice of you to turn up. I see you've met my cousin, Averina." Flick raised her eyebrows. "Cousin? I thought you said you didn't have any family." "All right, you pedant. She's a sort of cousin. A Mercator married someone from Avery's world, as I understand it." He looked at Avery. "I think my great-great-uncle is your great-great-great-grandfather?" "Something like that," Avery shrugged. "Back in the day," she looked at Flick, "when the Strangeworlds Society was all over the place, in every world you can think of, they were doing more than simply exploring. Let's just say there are more than a few of us with real blood ties to this travel agency." Flick felt herself going red again. "Oh?" "Blood's pretty distant now, though," Avery added. "And my parents aren't Strangeworlds Society members. They don't even know I'm here." "My parents don't even know the Society exists," Flick said, getting one up on Avery. "It's a secret." "Wow, that must be tough," Avery said. "I'm so glad I could talk to my parents about it if I needed to. It's essential to have that closeness and support in your life, I think." Flick bit back something unpleasant and flashed a fake smile instead, before going to sit in one of the armchairs. Jonathan, apparently oblivious to the mood in the travel agency, straightened a few papers. "Felicity, Averina has brought us news of something I might need to investigate." "The house on the horizon," Avery nodded. is part of the Strangeworlds Society. Flick folded her arms.
Like the Travel Emporium in Five Lights?
Quicksparks? No, the house isn't like that exactly. It's not just storage. The house on the horizon is a safe house, Avery said.
As safe as you can get.
You can't physically get there, you see?
Flick blinked.
What do you mean? Jonathan began to explain how he thought the house worked, but it made Flick's head ache.
So, the location might be relative to the position of the person attempting to...
Okay, she said, wincing. I get it.
You can't get there. Probably. Unless we can find a suitcase that takes us to the house itself, Jonathan mused.
Flick looked at Avery.
And you think this Danza Thess person who lives there might know something about Jonathan's dad?
It wasn't a question. Avery shrugged.
It's worth a shot, isn't it? Someone who's been part of the society from the beginning might know more about Daniel than any of us.
Then you'll need me, Flick said. Avery raised her eyebrows.
You? I would need your assistance, yes, Jonathan said, ignoring his cousin. We need to look at all the suitcases with the magnifying glass.
Flick nodded.
So, what's the strategy once we find the right suitcase? We go to this horizon place, and then what? I'd quite like a plan this time.
Avery looked begrudgingly at Flick.
She's right, Johnny. We need a plan of attack.
Flick looked up in delight.
Johnny?
Jonathan ignored the nickname.
Yes, I shall do my research before we take off. The house isn't going anywhere, and until we know what might await us there, neither shall we. This Danza Thess character sounds like someone to be wary of.
Avery stretched, her shoulder and spine clicking like castanets.
Right then, pop through to see me if you find anything out. I'd best be getting back. My mother will be wondering where...
Her words dried up. Flick looked up, following Avery's eyeline.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.